back, I was initiated in May, the middle of May, the next month. It was called the Hare Krishna explosion. Things were happening really fast. So from there he went to New Vrindavan for the very first time, and just two carloads of devotees went with him. I was one of the people that got to be there for about a month with Srila Prabhupada in very austere conditions. A few months later, they didn't allow a single woman to live in New Vrindavan. So I wanted to go to the La Cienega temple in California because they had something called Sankirtan, and someone named Vishajan was taking devotees out. And so I moved to La Cienega. That was the summer of 1969. And we went on Harinam every day. It was really ecstatic. And one day, well, Tamal Krishna was the president. Of course, he wasn't a guru at this time. Everyone was getting married, and the household couples were going and opening temples. So one day, we didn't talk to brahmacharis, and one of the brahmacharis came up to me and said, Srila Prabhupada wants a temple in Japan, and I'm going to open a temple. I need a wife. Do you want to get married? I was like, really horrified. But I really wanted to surrender, and I said, ask Srila Prabhupada. The next thing I knew, he was doing our marriage ceremony in Los Angeles. It was the last marriage ceremony of him. And then, and just a few months later, I was in Japan. We didn't know anyone. We didn't know how to speak Japanese. It was just, I didn't even know my husband. I say my so-called husband, because we went with Bali Mardan, and those two hung out together. I was pretty much by myself. But anyway, we went, and we did Harinam every day, and we had Sunday feasts. And there's so many people in Tokyo. So gradually we were on TV and in magazines, and gradually everywhere we went, people go, Hare Krishna, Krishna. And then one day a box came. I didn't know anything about deity worship, but it was Lord Jagannath. And we didn't know too much. We made an altar, and we put them on the altar, and finally they got clothing. And then Srila Prabhupada came to Japan two times because all of the books being printed in Japan up until about 1972. So he came to oversee the book printing. He sent Brahmananda to stay for a little bit. And so these deities, the first time Srila Prabhupada came to Japan, he had just given the biggest sannyas initiation. And he brought all the sannyasis. We lived in this tiny little place. There was no room for me. I was the only Mataji in the temple. I was trying to be invisible and with all these young sannyasis, and I was sleeping out in the car. There was no room for me. And it was like really kind of embarrassing. But anyway, it was nice because Srila Prabhupada was there, and we got to also celebrate Vyas Puja and Janmashtami. That's described in Borjan Prabhu's book, The Glorious Master, how we messed up on the Vyas Puja because Srila Prabhupada said he wanted Pushpa, which means flowers, and none of them knew what Pushpa was. And someone thought it meant rice. So somebody cooked a big pot of rice, and when it came time to offer the flowers, we had flowers, we had a big pot of rice. And Srila Prabhupada actually left in the middle of the Vyas Puja, and we thought this is the end of the world. Srila Prabhupada wasn't happy about it. And we thought, oh, we're finished now, you know? And but somehow or other, they went to his apartment, and he said he would come the next day, we could try it again. And which we did, and he came like nothing had happened. He was smiling, and he said the reason he was upset because he had just initiated so many sannyasis, and not one of them went and really asked them how to do the ceremony properly. So he's teaching us this example. So the second time Srila Prabhupada came, I guess my so-called husband had been thinking about taking sannyas since his friend had taken sannyas. So I remember he came out and he said, I just asked Srila Prabhupada if I could take sannyas. I said, oh. And Srila Prabhupada said, I would have to give my permission. So I thought for a minute, and I said, okay. And I was kind of detached, but then I had to go to another temple. The nearest temple was Hong Kong, so I went to Hong Kong, and I brought the Jagannath deities. Now I have these deities. I still have these deities. 42 years later, these deities. At the time, these deities were. We had even a rock the altar in Japan. A lot of even Japanese don't know we had a big rock the altar. And these deities, the plan was that they were going to go to Hong Kong, and Borjam and his wife Jagatrini would take care of them. But in Hong Kong, they were talking about cutting off their wooden garlands, and I was saying, no, you can't cut the garlands off. And Borjam Prabhu said, you're so attached that you should keep these deities. But it hadn't really been authorized by Srila Prabhupada yet. From Hong Kong, I went with two devotees. We opened the temple in Manila in the Philippines. And after a few months, I got really sick and went back. I decided to go back to America. And when I went back, I stopped in Los Angeles. And most people were still living in the temple, so I had Jagannath in this blue box in the Brahmachari Ashram. And everyone was saying, you shouldn't have your own deities. What are you doing? Most people didn't have their own deities. They said, this isn't proper. And everyone was saying, Prabhupada said that. And the president was Jayatirtha, and I remember I was crying. And he said, Prabhupada said, we don't want to make you cry, but Prabhupada said. And I was always too shy to talk around Srila Prabhupada, but I was going to get up the courage to ask him myself. Because we could have darshan with Srila Prabhupada. So I went up for darshan, and I thought, I'm going to bring these Jagannath deities. So so I brought the deities up. And after Srila Prabhupada asked me a few questions about how the preaching was going in the Philippines, I got the courage and I said, Srila Prabhupada, I have Lord Jagannath in this box and I want them to see you. And I opened the box and stood them up. And Srila Prabhupada had the biggest smile. He said, they are gorgeous. And I said, Srila Prabhupada, everyone's telling me I can't worship these deities. And he said, who's telling? I wrote all this down so I remember exactly what he said. I still have the paper with me. And then I actually said, but Srila Prabhupada, you said, and he just interrupted me, he said, never mind. You make Lord Jagannath your life and soul, and you will be happy your entire life. And then he said, so your husband has taken sannyas? I said, yes. He said, two times he said, then you just make Lord Balaram your son, Subhadra your daughter, and Lord Jagannath your husband. He said, because every woman needs a husband, son, and a daughter. He also gave some instructions like don't divert your mind and treat them as God. He said take them wherever you go, inside or outside the temple. And I was thinking, outside the temple? I'm not going to be outside the temple. And at the end of the conversation, I said, Srila Prabhupada, is there a chance of me ever going back to Godhead? And he said, you just do what I told you and you will become fully liberated, Krishna conscious, and go back to Godhead this very long time. I'm not saying I'll do anything like that. But so after that, wherever I went, Lord Jagannath was on the altar. He's been on the altar in Calcutta, in Bombay, in Dallas, in Toronto, in Chicago, in Detroit. Up until, you know, I'm getting older now, so now I keep them in my room. Because he did say, she can keep them in the room and offer fruit, water, and tulsi. And maybe that's all I have time for, but anyone that would like to talk to me, I really would need some association because I'm the only woman that ashram in Detroit, so please come and talk to me. Hi.